Well, fast forward to age 18. I entered the Peabody Conservatory of Music. I was so fortunate and so grateful. I received a scholarship on bassoon. I was there as a double major in piano and bassoon. My dream had come true. I was able to be at a fantastic institution in Baltimore. It's Peabody, part of Johns Hopkins. It was a great, great place to be. My freshman year, I was so excited, and I got to give my first full-length solo piano recital. I was looking so forward to this. It was going to be just another joyous time to be able to share music. And up until this point in my life, every experience I had had with music making was essentially joyous. It was very natural to perform, very natural to share the music, because this is what I loved, and this is what I was preparing, and this is who I was. But something very, very strange happened to me. I was 18 years old, and I had this wonderful program prepared. But about 15 minutes before the recital began, I did something really kind of dumb. I decided to peek and see, I was backstage, and I just wanted to see, is anybody here? You know, who's in the hall? Kind of what's happening out there? Well, at that moment, I saw all of these students filing in. It looked like the whole world was coming to judge me, and this is why I felt that way. One of the works that I was performing that night was the Berg Sonata, a contemporary composer, Alban Berg, and I saw these scores. I saw the graduate students, I don't know, they all looked old, and they looked like they were there to judge me. And so it was not only the faculty, but it was like all the students, and they all came with their scores, the scores of the musical manuscripts with all of the notes. And at that moment, I had the most paralyzing performance anxiety, stage fright, call it what you will, I was a total wreck. And I remember I just kind of slumped down. I thought, I cannot do this. I can't do it. They're here to judge me. This is going to be the end. I'll be sent home from Peabody. It's back to the farm. I'm done. I can never do this again. I can't do it. And so I went into the green room. The green room is, you know, right behind the stage. And I just started sobbing, and I thought, I don't know what to do. I'm going to look for an exit. So I quick, you know, where's the door? I'm going to get out of here. Maybe I'll escape, and I'll be sick. I was feeling sick. That's it. I'm sick. I can't do it. And they'll just make an announcement. She's sick. At that moment, there was a knock on the door. I thought, oh my gosh, somebody's here, and I'm a mess, and I'm crying, and I'm a mess. Like, nobody can see me. Okay, but I had to open the door. Well, it was Professor Julio Esteban, my piano teacher. He took one look at me, and he knew I was a mess. These words are immortal. This is what he said to me in his impeccable Spanish accent. My dear Linda, why are you so selfish? Selfish? I'm blurting out. I'm just petrified. I'm scared. I can't do this. He was stern, and he said, you are selfish. You think this recital is about Linda Apple. It is not. It is about the music. And you are not thinking about the music. What composers are you playing? What are the pieces you are doing? You love this music. You've prepared this music. You've worked on this for a full semester. You have this learned. It's a part of you. Do you not realize the music flows through you? You're simply the vehicle. It's not about you. You're sitting there or standing there or sobbing there, whatever I was doing, all worried about Linda Apple, it's not about you. Don't you understand this? You're the vehicle. Without you, the music stays on the little black dots on the page. You get to bring the music alive. You get to make it happen. That's our gift as performers. We get to share this gift that we so love. Well, he got my attention, all right. I realized at that moment, he was absolutely right. This fear that I had really had nothing to do with the music. It had to do with me and my own insecurities at that moment, and that I was being judged, and that maybe I shouldn't be a Peabody, and all this stuff that was going through my head as a freshman. When I pulled myself together, by now it's probably 2 minutes before the concert, and it's like, okay, think, focus. Think about the phrasing, do what you need to do. And you know, the concert actually ended up being fine. I don't remember it terribly well, but I know it was, once I get out there, it was, you know, it was just fine. But that lesson has stayed with me forever, because we all have times in our lives where we doubt, am I ready at this moment? Or it is life. What is thoroughly important is that we've prepared. I mean total preparation. Because if we're not prepared, if we're not prepared musically, if we haven't done the work that is necessary to really be ready to perform, well then we probably shouldn't be on stage at that moment. But assuming the work has been done, the preparation has been done, then it should be an incredible privilege and joy to get to share something that we have this opportunity to give others. So as we think about stage fright and performance anxiety, what is it about this that is so riveting and that causes such deep emotional outpouring from us? Why do we have all of these physiological things that will happen when we have this sudden terror? And what can we do to overcome that? How can we minimize those physiological negative things that can occur to us when we have those moments of insecurity? I would like to suggest several things. Again, there is no shortcut for preparation. That is always, always the key. You must be thoroughly prepared. And then I would like to suggest that we truly focus on what it is we're called to do, whether it's giving a speech, whether it is performing a piano solo, whether it is singing, whether it is dancing, any of the performance arts. When we are in that moment, we have to live in the present, and when we are there, ready to give of this art form or whatever we are asked to give, we must make that moment be the best that it can be, because we have prepared and we're ready now to be able to deliver something that's meaningful. We have to believe in what we're doing. We have to know within ourselves that this is something meaningful. It's something that is worth someone's time to come here. It's something that we feel strongly about, that we want to share. So it is that sense of there must be an intelligent approach to it, but there also has to be the passion that we know beyond the shadow of a doubt, this is something that I believe in. This is something that is important, and this is something that I want others to be able to experience because it has real worth. What do we do as performers when it is time? It is that magic moment that we've been waiting for, when we get to deliver this music that we've been so, so anxious to be able to share. What goes through one's head? And how do we try to make sure that we're, quote, in the zone, or that we're able to give our best at that moment so that we don't have all these other things getting in the way? Intense focus on what it is we are called to do. Intense focus on the task at hand. Not allowing ourselves to even take the time to focus anywhere else. Because if we're fully engaged in what it is we're delivering, we're thinking about the phrasing, we're thinking about the melodic structure, we're thinking about the harmonic, it doesn't matter what vocabulary it is, but whatever it is we're doing, we're fully engaged, and our thoughts are about delivering this so that it has impact, so that it has meaning to the audience, and so that people can be brought up into this world that we are wanting them to experience in whichever art form we are dealing with. So, as we sit down to perform, let's go to a moment of music. I'd like to just kind of go through some thoughts as one is getting ready to play. Thank you so much. So one is walking on the stage and one is thinking about what we're about to experience. I would like us to think for a moment. Okay, we're here. Now, what is it we're trying to project? The piece, I'm just going to do short little fragments of several pieces. At this moment, we're having a melancholy, kind of a wistful melody. We're being transported into a different place. There's a soft, little bit of a rollicking, lilting left hand that's actually a slight dance. But on in the melody in the right hand, there's this longing. And so it's our job to make sure that all comes through, the voicing, the tone quality, and that we transport our audience into this very beautiful place by a wonderful Spanish composer, Isaac Albéniz, a short fragment of Evocación. It's only a fragment, but it transports us, does it not? Are we not in a slightly different place than we were just a minute earlier? So to be a performer takes risks. It means being willing to put yourself out there. And we are imperfect creatures. It is very, very difficult, and I find this often, you know, as a teacher, that so many times students will feel so upset if they feel they've not done a perfect performance. And this sense of perfection that sort of drives our society and our, you know, and our wonderful work ethic of, you know, we want things to be perfect. We strive for perfection. And in the practice room, we are striving constantly for perfection and accuracy, you know, with the notes, the rhythms, the articulations, the phrasing, you name it, everything in the score, because it's our role to interpret faithfully what the composer has given us. But when we get on stage, we have to be willing to accept and realize that it may not be note perfect, but it can be a perfect performance. It depends on what we mean by the word perfect. In my mind, perfection is in the delivery. When you have connected with your audience, when you have connected with another human being on a deep level through what it is you are sharing, you have made something real happen at that moment. And it's memorable. And it's something that is very precious. What I believe is that perfection of delivery, or perfection of the musical line, perfection of trying to make sure the intent, the musical intent comes through, that to me is what musical performance is all about. And so when we change that view, perhaps, of perfection from going to, I must have it note perfect, or I'm feeling devastated, to, I must communicate with my audience in a real way, I think that frees this stage fright, musical anxiety to some degree. Just a shift on a word, but a very powerful word. Play or sing with intelligence and with passion. Both are essential for success in performance. Prepare thoroughly. Focus on the emotions and excitement of the music. Do not focus on yourself and your anxiety, or you will be like I was back at age 18 when it was a mess. Do not be selfish. Share with joy that which you've been given. Have an attitude of gratitude as you walk on stage. What a privilege it is to be able to share what we love. Johann Sebastian Bach wrote on all of his scores, "Solo Deo Gloria," to God alone be the glory. This is my own personal statement that I have every time when I enter the stage, "Solo Deo Gloria." The focus is on a much higher power than oneself, that is for sure. Concentrate only on the task at hand. Therefore, there's no time left or energy left to be all scared and have all these self-doubts. Focus on what you have to do and make it happen. I like to think of music performance as the opportunity to give a truly special gift to our audience. I'd ask you to think with me in the following scenario. There's someone very special in your life that you want to be able to honor and show how much you care for that person. You want to buy or make or give this loved one a very, very special gift. You want this to be the most unique, personal, beautiful gift imaginable, because this person means so much to you and you want them to know your deep feelings. How does one go about preparing to deliver that gift? You probably would think about it months in advance. You would make sure that you have determined the venue or the place where you're going to give this gift. You would make sure that it's wrapped in the most beautiful package with the perfect bow and just all the sentiments in the card that are so uniquely yours. You will think about the words you want to say as you deliver this gift. And with joyful anticipation, you will think for many weeks ahead, oh, I hope they like this. I hope they love this gift as I hope they'll see how meaningful this is. And so there's a joyful anticipation of the day that you give this gift. I like to think of music performance in that same way. We prepare for months. We get to choose repertoire that we love, or maybe our teacher has chosen it for us, but anyhow, we there's choice in what goes into that recital. We prepare it thoroughly. We are all dressed up in our concert gown or tuxedo, so that it's a beautiful presentation. We have the lovely concert hall, a magnificent instrument, beautiful printed program, all the details are there. And then we get to walk out on stage and deliver this gift that we've been preparing for months. And what a joy! There's an anticipation of, I hope that the audience understands and appreciates and really values this music. I hope that I can deliver this music in such a way that it really makes this afternoon memorable for the audience, that there's something they will take home from this and they will feel like they are in a better place for having attended this recital. I hope the music is meaningful and truly, truly memorable beyond just that immediate setting. Music is a gift. And when we deliver and when we prepare and we put our focus on where the focus should be, the music itself, Stage fright, performance anxiety, they disappear. I would like to close by giving a very personal gift. And this is, again, a very short fragment of a beautiful piece that I hope will transport and perhaps close out this session in a very meaningful way. Thank you so much.